All right, I don't know if I'm recording or not, but.
Hey, John.
Yes, sir.
Let's get started.
All right, let's do it.
Sean, you could lead this. You've been already, you've sat in on this twice.
It's my third time in 3 weeks. I enjoyed it.
Don't forget your mic.
What about it?
Put that mic on.
All right.
I feel like a star.
All right, so you see there is a website. If you'll go to that, if you wish, you don't have to. Actually, because I'm having a hard time seeing my tabs, I may not be able to see the results anyway. But there's a Survey Monkey. If you want to go to that, fill it out. Where is that? Does that work?
Yeah, and then you just push the little...
Is that,
there it is.
Okay. So there's this Survey Monkey. If you want to, there's two questions on there. If I remember to look at the results during the session, we'll take a look at where we are. Got a couple people straggling in here, so we'll wait for them. Come on. You might learn something.
Good luck. Yeah, good luck with that one.
Yeah, exactly.
Learn.
Educate.
All right, so for those of you who just came in, there's a link to a SurveyMonkey if you've got a device that's connected right now, if you want to fill that out, feel free. You don't have to if you... All right, let's go ahead and get started. Oops, I guess. All right, there we go. Okay, so... presentation, making your responsive sight picture perfect. As you see, I've given this session a couple times, so hopefully I've got it well honed. Just a quick review of who I am. I am a developer at DS Federal. I work from home. DS Federal is actually based in Maryland, and they're primarily a government contractor. I work on a couple of sites. Right now, one is healthit.gov. It's part of the Department of Health and Human Services, and I'm wrapping up a project with the Office of Research Compliance with the University of Hawaii. I put my Drupal user number down to show that it's a low number, but that doesn't mean that I am a wizened Drupal user. I've actually, but the first several years that I worked in Drupal, I just kind of dabbled in it. And about 5 or 6 years ago, I went to my first Drupal camp, and I thought, oh, I guess I kind of know some of this stuff. And so that's when I started to take Drupal seriously. And it wasn't until November of last year, though, that I became a full-time Drupal developer. If you have interest in this subject, you can download my presentation where you will get all the links. I've included a lot of links in this presentation, so that's a good way to get the presentation either in PDF form or the full code, as you see. I'm using the, what do they call that? Response.js or I don't know, whatever I'm using. So what are we trying to do here? Well, first of all, I should qualify this presentation as being intended for essentially a beginner level Hopefully, even if you're not a beginner, that you will learn something. I'm covering a lot of information. As I said, though, I'm not covering it in a lot of detail. But if you want the detail, there are lots of links. So if you want to delve into one piece of it, it's very easy to do. If I can, let's see. Like I said, I don't know what happened to my tabs, and I had this all set up to be able to see the results of this presentation, but I think we can. So we had let's see. We only had 4 people fill it out, but 3 people or 3/4 say they have sometimes worked in the front end, and 1 person says most of the time in the front end. And let's see. Looks like there is a fair amount of familiarity with responsive design. That's good. Somewhat familiar with, one person's familiar with sprites and font icons. And looks like you're in a good spot because it looks like, as I said, this is a beginner presentation. So it looks like we're, let's see. Sorry for the fumbling around here, but it's really hard to see when I'm working in a screen like this. There we go. Okay. So, as I said, the goal here is to learn about how to make your website picture perfect, or how to use images in your website. So what we're, the goal really is, of course, to have great looking websites. But what does, I'm sorry, I'm confused here because I'm seeing the slide I'm supposed to look at, but this says it's the next slide, so I don't know. that's obvious. Everybody wants a great looking website, but what are we really talking about here? Well, we're talking about making websites that look great on any device. And by any device, I don't mean just mobile devices, desktop devices, or even TVs. I'm actually talking about any device that maybe hasn't been invented yet, because the websites that you're building today will hopefully last a few years, and probably in that amount of time there will be new devices. So we don't know what those devices are going to be size-wise, or how they're going to be, what kind of resolution they're going to have. We want to be able to create websites that will be able to handle those when that time comes. So it turns out there is a little bit of CSS that will take care of what we're trying to do. If you add max width 100% to your image in CSS, you will make your images responsive. And that's all there is to do to make your images responsive. Well, almost, except it doesn't quite work in Internet Explorer 6 or 7. But if you just make it width 100%, you can take care of Internet Explorer 6 and 7. And that is how you make responsive images. Thank you very much. Hope to see you at the gathering this evening. Of course, I'm sure you didn't expect me to make it that simple. unfortunately, it's not. Well, what's wrong with max width 100%? Well, there's actually two reasons why that's not good. First of all, what you're trying to do is you're trying to take an image of a given size and make it work for every device, and that isn't an appropriate thing to do for the reason of that image is probably going to be too big for some devices or perhaps too small for others. So especially the smaller devices like a phone, you're trying to take, you're trying to make the user download a large image and then squeeze it down to the device size. And that's not fair to the user because they're downloading a large file that they can't really even see properly. So the other problem with this is that now with high density displays, we are trying to, we're not taking advantage of those when we take one image and we change the size of it. This little example is, let's say we have this image of 100 by 100 and we took just a small section out of that to analyze it. In a standard density image, let's say that's a 2 pixel by 2 pixel chunk. In a high density display, we would be able to see twice, it's generally considered as a two times resolution, but keep in mind that when we have 2 by 2, when we multiply that by 2, we're really creating 4 times the number of pixels. It's the same size display, but the pixels are 4 times as many. So those are the two reasons why we can't just take the same image and make it useful for all devices. So we need the right tools in order to be able to make this work. In this presentation, we're going to talk about several. We're going to talk about media queries, breakpoints, CSS, preprocessor, or SAS. If you were in the last session, hopefully you gained a lot of information about that. Compass, which works with SAS, sprites, icon fonts, modernizer.js, and vector graphics. So we're also, because this is a Drupal presentation, we're going to use two modules, breakpoint and picture module. So just to make sure that we all have a good understanding, though, of what we're talking about, let's get first a some definitions. Media query is a way of defining a section of your defining your device or your display for your CSS. In other words, you're limiting how much of that CSS is being used per the display that's being seen. So generally, we think of media queries as the width of the display, but it doesn't have to be. It can be the orientation of the display. It can be other factors like resolution can go into writing a media query. And the media query is then used in something like this, where we have max width is one, and we're using some portion of our CSS just for that type of display, and then maybe a different max width uses a different section of the CSS. What this really is breakpoints. So if you've heard of the term breakpoints, a breakpoint is a media query. And what we do in the breakpoint is we change different parts of our display to per breakpoint. Usually we think of that in terms of the width of the display. Again, it doesn't have to be, it can be resolution, but what we're doing is we're making the display, the layout or the colors or the image sizes or the number of columns, we're changing those per the breakpoint. We also, in terms of responsive design, we have to take into consideration the multiplier, which I just pointed out earlier with retina displays or what have you. The multiplier is that factor of how many extra pixels the display can handle. A lot of the retina displays and what have you now are at 2x or a factor of 2. Some of the displays are at 1.5x, and there are actually some now that are coming out with 3x. So you have to take into consideration the resolution, and you think of it in terms of the multiplier. We mentioned CSS preprocessor. If you were in the last session, you know what I'm talking about. There are different kinds of preprocessors. I'm going to be referencing SAS because that seems to be the type of preprocessor that people have gravitated to, and that's the one that I use, and I think these days most people do. We're also going to talk about Compass, because Compass is generally used with SAS. Compass is a way of extending SAS by using some reusable elements that are automatically imported into your SAS. As I said, we're going to talk about Picture Module, and what Picture Module does is it makes use of a picture fill polyfill. Now, if you don't know what a polyfill is, all it really is some JavaScript that allows your browser to do things that natively it can't do. In this case, the picture fill polyfill allows for the use of code like this, where you're using a picture tag and you're also using a source tag within the picture tag and source set. These are not possible without the picture fill polyfill. The picture module is what makes all this happen. The picture module is available in Drupal 7 and is going to be part of core in Drupal 8. So that's one of the reasons why it's a good idea to adopt that method of responsive images rather than some of the other methods that are out there, because this is using the latest generally accepted method. It's the picture tag is going to be part of newer browsers anyway, and eventually you won't need the picture fill polyfill for that. So this using the picture module allows you to use technology that is essentially future-proof. As much as you can be future-proof, I guess. So anyway, as I said, it allows you to use these tags that you otherwise would not be able to use. And the reason why this is important is because in one picture tag, you are actually providing different images. The standard image source equals, that's what everybody's familiar with in HTML. And that's, in this case, it's being used as the fallback. We're allowing for other sized images with, as you see, the media query is built right into the image tag to provide for different images depending on the displayed depending on the media query. And excuse me. And what the Polyfill then does is it only displays whichever is appropriate to the media query, with the final one being the fallback in case the browser can't handle the other two. The way we make use of the picture module is actually through another module, the breakpoints module, which allows you to set the breakpoints that you're using for your site within the structure of your site in terms of the delivery of the images. At this point, when we're talking about the breakpoints module, we're not talking about CSS. We're talking really about how image styles, which is a module that you probably are familiar with if you've done any Drupal development at all, because it's part of core, the breakpoints module works with the image styles to deliver the images that are then displayed through the picture module. So the result being that through picture module and breakpoints module and image styles, we can display different images depending on the circumstances. And it's the image styles that are actually resizing the images for these different circumstances. You can also use the image styles to change the density. So for different high density displays and what have you. Here's an example of how we've set up the image styles module to take a 100 by 100 image and then resize it to 200 by 200 to make it useful for a high density image. Now you'll notice that I'm doing here is just enlarging it to 200 by 200. Then when it gets displayed through the HTML, it's resized back down to 100 by 100, and that's how we end up with the 4x pixels. All we're doing is just blowing it up, which, as you know, if you just blow up an image twice its normal size, it becomes fuzzy, but that's okay because we're resizing it back down. All we've done in this process then is putting that factor of 2 to the number of pixels. So here's an example of using SAS to create our breakpoints. Now, why am I showing this when we've been talking about the modules and whatever? Is that what you want to do is you want to work out your breakpoints before you start messing with your images. So as you're developing your site, it's probably a good idea to not even introduce picture module and breakpoints module until you've got a lot of the other parts of your design figured out. The way that I work, and I think that this is kind of the best practices method of developing sites, is to start working on your mobile version of your site. And as you start to widen out and start to make changes, you are then starting to think about the breakpoints. What I do is I start changing the width of my display, and when I see that something doesn't look as good as I want it to look, that's where I make a breakpoint. I'm not worried about how it's going to look in an iPhone or how it's going to look in an Android device, because I don't really know what that device is going to be tomorrow or a year from now as what is going to be the standard width. I'm only concerned about what is looking good now at this width. And as long as I continue whiting it out and it's still looking good, I'm not going to change anything until it starts to look like this image is too big, or the menu is spread out too much, or whatever. At that point, then I say that's where I'm making a break point. So depending on the type of site, I may have one or two breakpoints, or I might have a half dozen. It's not a matter of designing for devices, it's designing for what looks good at certain widths. So, this is SAS, and you'll notice that what I've done here is I've named the breakpoints to things that are not, don't really have anything to do with the size. I haven't named this mobile or iPhone or anything like that. I've named it hamburger. Now, why hamburger? Well, hamburger, if you think of the hamburger menu icon, that is for a mobile device, right? But the reason why I named it hamburger is that tells me, as long as I'm using that breakpoint, the hamburger icon appears. When I use the tabs breakpoint, that's when it changes from the hamburger icon to a menu with tabs. That way, I don't have to remember, well, at 420 pixels it changed. No, it just, when I designed it so that I went from hamburger icon to tabs, that's where the breakpoint is. I don't have to worry about what an actual width is. I care about what the display looks like, and it helps me remember that. So as you'll see, what I'm doing here is I'm using the compass extension called breakpoint to work with SAS to help me do that, because when I use the breakpoint compass extension, all I have to do is enter a single number for my breakpoint, and the extension does the rest of writing that media query that you would expect to see, at media, et cetera, et cetera. All I have to do is write a single variable with assign it a number, and the extension does the rest. You'll see that I've included a link to a SASmeister page that if you want to play around with that, you can. Remember what I said, that what we're doing is we're doing all these changes in your breakpoints first before you start messing with the images and with picture module and breakpoints module. The reason is you want to have all that worked out so that when you go to enter the breakpoints into the breakpoint module's configuration, you only have to do that once. A lot of times you're making a lot of changes and you're adjusting where that breakpoint is in the first stages of your design, and you may make several changes before you kind of get settled on the number of breakpoints and where those breakpoints fall. So this saves you a lot of effort by waiting until you have that work done. Then what is really handy about the breakpoints module is that it allows you to take some settings that look like this and just paste them into your .info file of your theme. And if you follow this format, starting with the breakpoint order of largest to smallest, and paste that into the .info file of your theme, it will automatically get sucked into the module like this. you'll have to clear the cache to make it actually happen, but that is how, then you don't, in other words, the point being here is that you don't have to manually enter all this into the module configuration. You can do it just through the text file. Then the other step that you have to take after you've entered the breakpoints is you have to assign image styles to the breakpoints. You don't have to assign image styles to every breakpoint, but where you want an image to change, say in size or in dimension, maybe you want to go a square image in your small displays, and then you want to go to a rectangular image and some wider displays. That's you have to map that through the breakpoints module. You will also map in where you have your different resolutions, so that your multiplier is taken into consideration as well. The final step that you need to do after you've mapped your images into the breakpoints module is you have to go to the configuration for your content types and change what would be a standard of image if you're using an image field and changing it to picture. Then you have an additional I don't have a picture of this in my presentation, but there is there are groups of these image styles that you also have to select what group you're choosing. So the result of all this is that depending on the type of display, if you've done it right, you will not only get the right sized image, but you'll get the right resolution image with picture module and breakpoints module. And all that's great for images that are being inserted into your site by way of a image field in a content type. But as we know, that's not the only way in which we add images to a site. For example, we use icons frequently in our designs because those are handy for usability and they just look nice. But you don't use a image field to enter those usually, it's just part of your design. But you still need to make sure that those are appropriate for the resolution and appropriate for the screen size of your design. So what we want to do is, at least one way of doing this is through the use of sprites. Sprites are a fairly simple way of combining several images and then displaying only the right image with CSS. So here's an example where we've got an image that has lots of stars on it, but we don't want all those stars to be displayed. We want only, this might be like in a 5-star rating situation, and but with one image, we're going to change which number of stars is displayed with CSS. The point being here is that when the browser is loading several instances of these stars, we're only loading the image once, and then CSS determines through the different classes which number of stars is displayed. There are several ways that you can make sprites. Probably the easiest way to actually make the sprite image is through Photoshop. But unfortunately, that's kind of labor-intensive when you have to also then figure out the CSS that goes with that. So it turns out that there are some easier ways of doing it, one of which is to use online tools like SpritePad, which is free. You just go on there, you upload your images, and it automatically calculates the CSS for all that, and then you copy and paste that, and you save the, as I said, you're uploading all these images, and then it spits out one large image that you download and make use of that. There are also some low-cost applications that do the same thing, and the nice thing is that as you're developing, you may need to make some changes, so you can just go back and upload these again. Unfortunately, in the process of those, it may change some of your CSS because it may rearrange how those images are laid out in that one big image that's being spit out. So it can be a bit of a pain to maintain over the period of time that you're developing this. The other problem with sprites is that they don't necessarily save you as much bandwidth as you would think. You know, the point being that you're downloading one image and then using it multiple times. But for one thing, we may tend to try to put all of our images into that the site is ever going to see into this one sprite. Well, but yet on any given page, we may not need all of those images. The other thing is that when we are now designing for different resolutions, we're going to have different image sizes. And so then we're actually doubling or maybe even tripling the number of images that are going into the sprite, which is making to quite substantially sized image. And as I said, they're a pain to maintain because you may have to rewrite some CSS if you start adding more images to this sprite. So there is another way of doing this, and it happens to make use of Compass and SAS to do it. There is a Compass extension that allows you to put all of your images into one directory of your theme, and then through SAS automatically generate the single image, that sprite image, as well as all of the CSS that's necessary to display those. And it'll create variables then that you can apply to the rest of your SAS structure. So the downside of this is that the first time you build, throw all these images into a single directory, it'll take a while for that to be all crunched out and for it to spit out. But it is a much handier way of doing things because it's doing it on the fly and it has the added benefit of being in SAS. And though that's one good way of adding icons, there's another way that is handy because it is essentially taking a smaller file and it is scalable to pretty much any size you want, and that's through the use of icon fonts. As I said, they're scalable to any size, and you can, through CSS then, change colors and add shadow and things like that that you can't do with a sprite. You don't have any problems with cross-browser compatibility with icon fonts. The only downside really is that you can't get real complex images. They have to be essentially a single color. And you can run into accessibility problems if you're not careful, because sometimes the code that you is often used in displaying an icon font involves a letter for that font. I mean, when you think about it, it is a font just like any other text font. So a letter will represent an icon. Well, the accessibility issues come in when people are using screen readers to, because they have a sight impairment, the screen reader will attempt to read that character unless you have taken extra steps to code around that. One good thing about icon fonts is that you can actually build your own fonts through tools like the ones that I've listed here. What they do is they take libraries of these icons and they provide you with the ability to select the icons that you want from those libraries and then save that as a file that you can then download, so you're not forcing yourself your site to download a large font when you're only using a small number of icons within that font. Now, there's actually another way that you can add icon fonts, and it's the Drupal way. There is a Font Awesome module that uses the Font Awesome library, which is one of the largest font icon libraries available. There's over 480 icons the last time I counted. And it has all the convenience of the icon fonts, but also the convenience of a Drupal module. Now, the downside is you're making use of the entire font, but you have a lot of convenience, and there may be times when you will want to use that. For example, I had a situation where the design called for the use of lots of different icons, but they depended on the content that was being created on the fly. So essentially what we had to do is we had to provide a mechanism for the content creator to be able to select an icon dependent on the content that they were creating. And we didn't necessarily know all the different kinds of content that they'd be creating, so we made use of the Font Awesome library through this module. And so all I had to do is they had to go to the Font Awesome library website and see all the classes that are provided and enter the class name as the icon. And so then when they saved their content, it automatically pulled that as the class for displaying the icon. Unfortunately, font icons or icon fonts don't cover all types of icons and logos. A lot of times you have situations where you have multiple colors. And so you're going to have to go to a standard image or what is actually better than a JPEG or a PNG is an SVG or vector graphic. The reason is that you get the advantage that the icon fonts give you being scalable to any resolution, but you don't have the limits of being just one color. Most people don't think about SVG images on their websites because it used to be most browsers would not display SVG images. And most people, when they think of vector, they think of Illustrator or either the .ai files or the, what's the other extension? Anyway, EPS. You know what I'm talking about. Yes. EPS, exactly. So, but it turns out that the issues with browsers are pretty much gone. And yet you are able to take advantage of all the other advantages that the SVG gives you. The The range of browsers that support SVG is now pretty much what you would expect and or want. The only caveat there is Internet Explorer 8. A lot of people have kind of gotten away from trying to support Internet Explorer 7 or 8. So that may not be a problem, but there are some instances where you are expected to still develop for IE 8, for example. Well, yes, and you know, like I, a client that I worked with, they were concerned about IE8 because they knew that some of their audience was on the Pacific Rim, where a lot of people are still using Windows 7 or maybe even or XP, where you're limited to what browser you can use. So in a case of that, you may have to write a fallback if you want to use an SVG image. But I wouldn't let that stop you from using SVG images, because you're otherwise saving yourself the trouble of having to create different resolutions, versions of the same image. So it turns out that saving an image in as an SVG is very simple. A lot of times your client is giving you their logo as an Illustrator file anyway. Illustrator makes it possible to save as an SVG image just by selecting save as format. Then when you apply it to your website, a lot of times all you have to do is just add it just like you would any other image. You're just using the source as the SVG image rather than the JPEG or PNG. Now, there are a lot more things that you can do with SVG images that I'm not going to get into. In fact, you could have different layers of an SVG, which allows you to do things, and each of those layers can have its own class, so that you can change how that image looks depending on what classes you're assigning, and you can do that by breakpoints and all that kind of stuff. So you can also do interesting animation things with SVG images. So again, I'm not going to get into all those things, but that's just one more reason why you really should start looking into SVG images for your websites if you aren't doing it now. So, again, as I pointed out a little while ago, you may run into situations where you still have to design for an older browser. So what are you going to do? Well, one way is to make use of Modernizer. It's a JavaScript file that you're adding to your site that does a device detection. And you're not detecting the type of device, you're detecting what the device can handle. So it's the features that it can handle. And you can select the ones that you care about, so you can control the size of that JavaScript file that you're loading, so you're not detecting. If you don't care about certain features, you don't have to detect for those. What Modernizer then does is it applies additional classes to your HTML tag, which you can then use as part of your CSS styling. There's a SassMeister where I've attempted to demonstrate that. Unfortunately, with SassMeister, you can't apply a CSS class to the HTML tag, so I had to simulate that by applying it to a div. But the basic idea is that the Modernizer can detect whether or not your device can see an SVG image, for example. You don't have to be concerned about IE8 necessarily. You can just say, can it see SVG? That's one way of handling it. And as you see, here's another way of handling it, and that is by using the Breakpoint SAS extension that we talked about earlier, but this time we're writing it so that the resolution is the breakpoint, and we are saying that device of a certain resolution will display this image, and if it's of a different resolution, it will display this image. And that may be a way, for example, to handle the IE8 problem as well, because I think you can presume that if somebody is using IE8, they're not using a high-resolution monitor. I mean, it's a reasonable assumption, although it's maybe not necessarily true, but generally I think it's valid. If you're not sure what your device is able to see, there is a website that you can go to that will let you know what your device is at right now. Plus, if you scroll down on that page, you'll see all the devices that are matching that resolution. So that's kind of a handy thing to do. There's also caniuse.com. That's actually a screen grab from several weeks ago. They've changed the design of the site, but it will. All you have to do is say, okay, I'm concerned about whether I should be using this particular CSS or HTML5 feature. So you can enter that feature into Can I Use, and it will tell you all the browsers that it can handle and cannot handle that feature. So we talked about several things here. We've talked about making sure that the images are matching your appropriate display, but how do you know when you've reached that point? Well, first of all, you'll reach that point when the images change depending on the layout and context. And by that I mean the number of columns, the width, those factors that are part of the design. When the image changes appropriately, you are designing appropriately. Also, when the images are optimized for high-density screens, and when images are when you're using different mime types to take advantage of the ability of an image to adapt to the screen size and resolution automatically. So if you are interested in any more about this, I've got lots and lots of links in this presentation, which I'm just kind of skipping through, but if you download the PDF or the source, you can grab all these links. There is again the link to download all this. And I thank you very much. And if you have any questions, I know we're right at 5 o'clock, but I'll be around. You can ask a question now or you can catch me later. And thanks again. Or you can also get a hold of me that way.
Also be here now, later on.
Absolutely.
Can you go back to that website address?
Yeah.